Let's make it count.
I must practice tolerance.
Regeneration. Africa TV, Freak Up Studio Live.
You okay? Your cough is picking up on the microtosis.
I
got to turn my headset
up here.
I actually
didn't hear anything.
Welcome, guys. GSL time. It's Group H. How many letters are we going to have in this alphabet, Artosis?
That's it, Tasteless.
This is the last
one. We're stopping there.
We're stopping at H. We've gone too far.
Eight letters is more than enough for an alphabet.
Way too much.
Oh, my God.
So this is it. Tomorrow we have the group selection. That'll be at 8 p.m., so about an hour and a half later than we normally start here at the GSL. And they'll be moving on to the round of 16.
Yes, yes. The round of 16 group selection is always really fun, so do make sure you tune into that tomorrow. But for tonight, we have to see, can another Zerg make it through?
We can pray. Zerg's having a little bit of a hard time.
Well, it's Rogue, so I would imagine he's
going to
make it through. If he doesn't, I heard No Regrets going to eat a shoe.
By the way, he should be down here today.
Yeah.
He's finally back in Korea.
I know.
We've been doing a lot of casting lately. If you've just been following GSL, you should also be following our sister tournament, the ASL. We were just doing that last night. That's been awesome as well.
Yeah, ASL is going very, very well. We just cut to the round of eight. Some really great matches in there. It's been a very exciting season. So definitely check that out, because if you're watching this, then you like StarCraft, which means you like both StarCrafts, or you act like you don't because you actually don't understand.
Because you're biased and you're just like, I got to pick a side.
Yeah.
By the way, as you can see at the bottom of the screen, only three Zergs have advanced so far. Now, these are three very strong Zergs who could, I think it's very realistic they could get to a finals. But right now it seems like Terran's doing a little bit better than Zerg.
Well,
it's kind of like the Goldilocks race right now.
Yeah, no, they're skirting right exactly
it's
where they should be.
Just right where you can't quite complain.
Yeah, except Stats was eliminated, so that's pretty brutal. But
that was weird.
It's hard to get through as a Zerg when all the spots are being used up by Terrans, you know?
Yeah.
It's just like there's not enough spots for the Zergs because, like, every Terran and their brother gets through.
It's interesting because everybody was complaining, too, who was a Terran player, and then we have these results here.
Yeah.
So here's our schedule. We're moving days all over the place. So tomorrow, as I said, 8 p.m. group nominations. If you want to follow that, I am Katowice will be going on. So we're going to have to park GSL for a little bit, as many of our players who are advancing to the round of 16 are going to be in Poland for that. ASL will continue on through there. Mm-hmm. And then we start up with Group A round of 16 on, what is that, the 8th?
Friday. The 8th of March, definitely.
So we're going to have a Friday night cast and then a Saturday afternoon cast.
Yeah, so it's basically like 2 weeks off of GSL between the group nominations and the round of 16. But as Tasteless said, there is so much I Am Katowice that you can watch and so much ASL that you can watch in that time that you should be fine with it.
If you're a StarCraft person, this is a good time.
And then we're
going to
put I Am Katowice on hold for at least a year.
That's
and keep
right.
doing GSL.
Yeah.
So it's like only fair that we stay off for 2 weeks.
That's right. That's all we can do. We had a little bit of a later start here in 2019 for GSL, but we're finally back. A lot of days packed all together. I got to stop talking. There's a video coming.
Video is done. You can talk again.
I'm back. So our four players today, Zest, Patience, Alive, and Rogue. A lot of very storied players here.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of hard to... I'm, like, rooting for all of them, you know?
Yeah.
All these guys advancing is really exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Alive, a veteran of the GSL. Patience, one of the best Protosses out there, a very unique style. Zest has been on top of Protoss off and on throughout several years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious to see how he'll perform in 2019. He's definitely had periods where he is leading the front of Protoss.
Oh, absolutely.
And then there's moments where he gets bumped back. And Rogue, one of the world champions of StarCraft II.
That's right. A very exciting group. Definitely you look at it and say that Zest and Rogue are the favorites, but by no means are they locks to get out of this group. I think Alive is the least likely. Patience is... he's really strong, and he's been doing very well lately, so I'm interested to see how he does tonight. But let's talk about this man a little bit.
This beautiful man.
Hard to get more beautiful than that.
Two GSL first places and a second place. This guy's got a very specific approach to Protoss. He's very smart. He's very good with a lot of these Archon drops, very good at kind of getting momentum and keeping it and then maintaining that lead. I think he's a little bit less diverse as far as play styles when you compare him to somebody like SOS. I'm not really knocking on him, but I think if you watch a lot of his games, there's definitely... like Hero and SOS are definitely on the more abstract side of Protoss. Yeah. This is more of like a Zest, more of a very specific approach.
He finds, Zest finds like one or two builds that he really likes, and he optimizes builds better than any of the Protoss, in my opinion. He really will make the tightest, most ridiculous thing where it's like he's going to have, if he does it perfect, exactly the right amount of units to save his third base. And then you're screwed because you try to attack and he killed your sub. So he's a very top-end player in a meta that he really kind of is feeling. Patience, on the other hand, I was actually talking about this today, and I've talked about this a lot in the past. He's the hardest player for me to describe the way he plays.
Yeah.
It's impossible to put him into a box, and it's not because he's like SOS, who's so creative. It's something else. I don't even know what it is, and I can't put it into words well.
All right, game one is ready on year zero. Let's go, Zest versus Patience. Regeneration. 게임이 시작됩니다.
Year zero. 게임 준비 완료. OG.
An original gangster, no doubt.
Patience.
Yeah, so back to Patience. If you were to describe Patience, what would you say?
I'd say that he's someone who, as far as control goes, makes a lot of mistakes, actually, mm-hmm. but still ends up coming out on top. Like, he's got very good macro. He's got a good strategic understanding. Occasionally, his games are bumpy.
Okay.
But I think it's a hard. He's a hard one to put your finger on, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Ever since he was starting to do really well, like, back in SSL
Patience
days.
Beats Zest more often?
Wow.
I would not have guessed that.
Yeah. But, yeah, well, Patience is, like, a very underrated player because he makes a lot of moves that are... you know, sometimes even laughable. There's some hilarious clips of, like, in control casting him and stuff where it's just, you know, he does the patience blink where he, like, blinks his stalkers forward and loses all of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Where it's like, well, that was the opposite of what you're supposed to do there.
He's basically evidence that you can have kind of sloppy unit control and actually still beat the very best players in the world.
Well, he's... Ever since SSL, like, I tried to write an article on him once because he's such an enigma to me, right? And I went through every game he played up to a point and tried to put into words, like, what he is, what he does, why he's good. And it's so difficult because some of the ideas I have are, yeah, a lot of times he overcommits with units or his unit control is weird. And sometimes he gets out multitasked. I guess one of the best things I can say is he's very good at following a strategy. Like, he will get the unit set that he's going for. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. It's he knows what he's up to, but definitely a lot of the fights will be really clunky. But the thing is, even when he makes those weird mistakes, he sometimes still wins. So you look at it and you got to say, okay, he's really good.
He almost reminds me of, like, Movie from StarCraft 1 in a little bit of a way. Like, it just, I don't know, he's such an interesting player, though. It's, like, fun to watch what he has planned. He sometimes does some very peculiar things, but they end up working out quite often.
So in this game specifically, we have a proxied Robo and a proxied Gateway, whereas Patience is trying to expand out here. So Patience is going to need a Brace for Impact pretty quickly. Oh, my God. Here we go. Patience is going to scout this out, and he can actually hide in the, whatever this is, the seaweed. Being a seaweed nerd.
Yeah.
Hiding out over
there. Well, if that's seaweed, it's going to have to be kelp, right? But this is... I don't think this is
going to be the first game we're not going to get a shot of Amon in the top center of the map. That's the best part of this whole map.
I know, right?
My boy Amon.
Your boy.
My boy. Okay, so here comes the initial attack. Now, when the Immortal comes in here, that's where the pressure actually picks up.
And what he's doing, he's setting those shades, and that forces a lot of the units inside of Patient's Main to at least go back and respect the presence of the Adepts. Hmm. I'm not sure if he got a block off there to stop the shades. Yes, he did. He's using that pylon there. There's no Adepts. He can use the shade on his own. The first Immortal is out. Now, you don't want to get the second Immortal right away because the Warp Prism, being able to juggle that, whether it be Immortals or even the Stalkers or Sentries, is quite strong. Of course, Force Fields are going to be important, but there's not an unlimited amount of that either.
Yeah, yeah. He's going to have to just Force Field everything out for a little bit here,
I think. Funny. Look at that.
Huh.
Hallucinated Immortal. But I think you would know that you can't have a Robo out at this point in time with this build, right? So... I guess it does absorb hits, you know what?
Well, he's about to have his own real Immortal out here in a second. Hey, drops an Immortal in a couple centuries, so kind of a clever move there with the Force Field on the ramp. I'm not sure exactly how much he's going to do.
2011 strat here. I'll tell you what, though, it's working. He's definitely driving him back. He does not manage to get that pylon. Oh, actually, it looks like he might be able to do that.
Yeah, he should be able to pick that one off, but did he really do that much damage?
Doesn't seem like it. Unpowering one gate is nice. I feel like with this build, you really do want to try to push up the ramp onto the natural. And maybe we're going to see a little bit of that now.
This is kind of interesting. Zest actually going into more Robotech here, probably to grab a Disruptor. That can be very, very strong in a situation like this. Bash some of those sentries and whatnot.
So there's a Hallucinated Phoenix over here. Back at home, Patience is checking to confirm that Zest doesn't have a second base. So the longer this game goes on, if Zest doesn't do a lot of damage, Patience should pull through with a pretty big lead here.
Yeah, he definitely does need to get something done. Okay, so comes out here, throws down kind of a funny force field, getting a couple hits off, but this not really doing that much.
I don't mean to nitpick too much here, but isn't this a little bit odd? I mean, I feel like he should be pushing up. If you have a proxy, you haven't expanded yet, you have to do real damage. You can't just orbit around the outside of the base and try to do little pokes here and there.
You know, I don't disagree with you, but if you kind of look at it, right, they have a similar production right now as far as units. Zest is very much all in. He has to go for an actual kill.
I'm surprised.
And I think he's just waiting for the Disruptor to pull the trigger.
Okay, right now Patience is coming out on the middle of the map. This is a pretty serious surround, though. The Warp Prism is beginning to be pulled away. Five more Stalkers do come up. But right now this angling is just too good for Zest. Looks like the Warp Prism's taking some damage. Can he actually knock this out? He does!
Ooh, that's a very good kill on that Warp Prism.
Honestly, this was the only way that I think Patience could have lost this, was to try to go out there and do something when the other guy's powering up. Here comes that Disruptor now. Well, now, keep in mind, the Warp Prism was killed, so it's going to be a lot harder to avoid these shots.
Yeah, that's the real problem here, is losing the Warp Prism. Here comes the first shot. Pretty good. Pretty darn good. Can't be faulting that shot.
When you get these good Disruptor shots, it's not like a normal fight where you're kind of trading damage. You can just get a hit and not suffer any consequences on your side. So he should be chucking another Disruptor shot in there.
He actually sent his Adepts away. That means that there's no way he can hold on right here.
Okay, he's coming forward now. Here comes shoots down that Disruptor.
Yeah, really good.
But are there too many Adepts? He's juggled this other Immortal forward here.
I wonder if he can maybe just barely hold, like maybe he loses the natural, but he can hold up the ramp or something.
The thing is, this is not enough Adepts to destroy Zest back at home, right? Isn't it just four?
Yeah, well, he has to kill a pylon first, so there's a lot of time for Zest to react to that as well.
Okay, Zest is continuing to close through. Patience processes the loss. GG, Zest takes game one.
Yeah, so kind of an interesting thing. You said you didn't really like how he moved down the ramp. I think that might have been... It might have just been really bad, but also maybe he wanted to try to do something before the Disruptor was out. Because the Disruptor is like, that's what Zest was waiting for. That's why he was not attacking, is because he wanted to get that Disruption shot off and try to win with that. So I don't know. It was kind of an interesting game, though, there. It almost seemed as if Patience was going to hold, but Zest stayed calm and was able to kill him off.
It was a pretty elementary loss, honestly. If you got a guy who's powering up on one base, all you have to do is defend. It's not your job to go kill him. It's his job to kill you. You got to defend that. And when he came out on the map, that angling was just too good by Zest. One attack from the top, one from the bottom.
Yeah.
Sandwiching the army, it was hard to really utilize the Warp Prism to juggle it back and get warp ins. And we saw the Warp Prism go down. From there, you don't have anywhere near as many options or tools as far as micro goes to try to hold on in a fight like that.
He really needed to have that to hold on to the actual push so he could jump units out of the Disruptor.
All right, game two's up. Let's do this.
Automaton. Game 준비 완료. Oz. Jest. Patience.
Do you like Automator?
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, no Amon on this map. You know, that's always my first criticism of any map.
I know. Right? Jeez. You know what would be kind of cool is if, like, like the main bases just had like an Amon one in each. You know what I mean?
I think we need more Amons on maps. Man.
It's just like your base is right below an Amon, so you just watch and you find minerals on both sides of the map. I think that would be an amazing map.
Yeah, I think so.
Because you just make that terrain like unflyable, and it's just kind of this like artsy thing that's near your main.
Well, they had that in a lot of the Heroes of the Storm maps here.
What, Amon?
No, just a giant character or something in the background. Yeah, they did.
I'm trying to think of which character we're talking
about. This is when we kind of stopped playing. We were, but in some of the later maps, they definitely had some cool stuff in the background, big figures and stuff.
Okay. Maybe that's why you never won, Tasis. You look.
Oh yeah, I was too busy looking at that. Yeah. Okay. This time around, Zest came in here with an early scout. Oh wait, Patience isn't in a probe at all, right? Oh no, I'm sorry, I'm wrong. Patience also has a probe across the map. I was too busy looking for Amon. I didn't see. Sorry, everybody.
He's on the pirate ship somewhere.
Yeah.
So, looks like they're both opening up with that sentry for the quick scout. Throws down that pylon.
That's pretty cute.
Yeah, it's always a nice move because you know right when their units are going to finish, then you get to see what they make.
Yeah, and from there, even just seeing the first two units can usually give you a much better idea of what direction this game's going to be going in.
Now, both sides are actually going for Twilight Tech here. Likely to go into Blink. Anything else is a little bit weird.
Blink versus Blink can be a lot of fun to cast. And with that, they're both going for a quick Nexus here, trying to expand out.
I don't trust Patience to win a Blink versus Blink battle against Zest or really many pros. Like I will never forget the game where I believe it was Stats versus Patience in SSL a few years ago. And Patience had Blink, and Stats did not, and Stats won. He, like, literally, it was only a micro battle. Kept micro in both of them, and Stats won. And it's like,
well, that's supposed to be impossible, but I guess
that should be impossible, because everything he can do with his sockers, you can also. But also, you can make him disappear and reappear somewhere else.
Yeah.
So, like, it seems like Patience should have won that, and he couldn't. So I'm a bit nervous. I think Patience is someone who doesn't want to be doing the same strategy as his opponent.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I feel like he's definitely the kind of player where he needs to be doing his own thing and have his own angle to win strategically. I feel bad. I feel like we're knocking on Patience. We're really not meaning to. We've casted him enough times that we know his games can be a little bit bumpy and unpredictable.
The thing is, I really like him as a player. I like his play. It's again, I feel so weird talking about Patience. I feel so underqualified doing my job because a lot of people I can kind of give a brief description of how they play. That's pretty spot on. Obviously, there's like exceptions to the rule or they wouldn't be pros. But Patience is something else, man.
Okay, so Zess has popped out of the map and taken out that proxy pylon. And I don't believe Patience has any more hidden on the map. There's also a proxy pylon being made right at the 12 o'clock spot on the map here. I don't know if we've gotten a shot of it yet, but there is going to be the option for Zest to do some kind of a counterattack if he wants. So far, really good control here, honestly, with these probes. He takes out these two Adepts. Patience basically gets nothing out of this. Meanwhile, back at home, back at 12 o'clock, Zest is warping in some more Stalkers for a possible attack as Blink's finished.
Now, with the Dark Shrine on the way, as well as a Prism, a DT drop is pretty good against someone who only has Blink.
Yes.
You don't have detection. Look at this. He's making his Forge. The Here's Dark the Shrine is going to finish. The Prism's already out.
Where's the Prism on the map? I actually don't see it. Yeah, okay, there it is. There it is. Okay, so he actually didn't see that. How funny.
The
okay.
Warp.
Yeah. The warp and eyesight, not very good. Now, the damage is going to start being dealt right here immediately by Zest. But the fact of the matter is that DTs, if you can't get detection up, they will inevitably win the game unless you can somehow destroy all their buildings before they can stop you.
And with Blink, technically it's true. And he should realize now, it's like, oh, my opponent doesn't have Blink. If he throws down a couple cannons, maybe he can live through this.
Okay,
he actually forces him out.
Okay, there was also apparently a Depths. We just caught this over here. 7 kills on those probes. Where's that DT drop? Okay, here we go.
This is actually just going to kill him if he warps in 2 DTs. You send one to the natural, one to the main, and there's really not a whole lot you can do.
Yeah, there's a 3rd Nexus being made here. I'm taking a look.
Oh, okay. My God.
Yeah, Zest just noticed it. immediately taps out.
See that? All right. Nice strategy from Patience. They both were going Blink. He identified it and decided to switch it right up into a DT drop. I like it. Really punished Zest there.
Okay, so it's still up in the air as far as who's going to advance. Patience with a very strategic win there. You can see Zest was going for a little bit more of a tactical approach, but it doesn't matter if you don't have detection. We don't care what you're good at controlling.
No, it's true. DTs are one of the funny things that can just end a game.
Yep.
It's not too many things that just instantly end a game, but that is one of them.
And in case you guys are wondering why Zest didn't have any detection, he didn't anticipate DTs at all.
Yeah.
And not going for DTs, or not going for any, excuse me, any detection against the DTs usually means that if you're going head to head, you're going to have a much stronger army. You're much heavier and stronger on one side, one angle of the matchup.
And it was, there was something very specific that happened there too, right? Where the first hallucination comes in, scouts Blink. So you think it's Blink. The second hallucination he saved to Blink up into the main base. Otherwise, he could have scouted this in time.
Okay, game 3's ready on Kairos Junction. Let's do this. Let's go.
Kairos Junction. Game 준비 완료. Ozzy, Jest.
Tied up 1-1 right now.
Patience.
You know what it is, I think? I think one of the reasons that I quite like Patience Tasteless is he's really a Protoss's Protoss. A lot of the way he plays is what makes a lot of players angry at Protoss, you know?
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Where, like, even as a Protoss player, Zest could look at that last game and be like, oh, are you serious?
Yeah.
If I don't try to Blink into your main base there and I just scout normally with my second hallucination, you lose. Not lose, but obviously Zest gets a big lead at that point.
Well, Zest doesn't die, right?
yeah. And, you know, it's kind of a funny thing about Patience, I guess. You make a giant army, like a death ball, and walk around with it, and you're like, wow, this is really hard to deal with.
So true.
Oh, man.
So let's see what Patience does this time around. We have Zest scouting Patience. Patience has a probe headed northbound. Try to get inside the main here of Zest.
Yeah, he'll get in there without any problems. Just check out that everything is normal. Not a whole lot of things you can do with this initial probe. Kind of keep it alive, maybe throw the pylon down. You can check what they're chronoing, whether it's gateways or the cybernetics core. And you can count gas as well. Just click on the geysers and see, did they bank a little bit extra or something like that.
Right. Back at home, it appears as though Zest is setting up for expand or making it look like he's set up for expand. Meanwhile, Patience with a proxy pylon adjacent to the main of Zest.
Mm-hmm. And Zest actually throws down a Stargate, which is very likely what Patience might be throwing down here. Ah, Robo instead. Okay, so I would guess that this is going to be Robo 3-gate going up against Stargate. And this is, I talked about this a little bit because we saw this build order matchup previously in GSL. And it's definitely something that you see the Korean pros run into each other with. These are definitely two of the builds considered quite powerful.
Yeah, keep in mind, this is actually looking kind of similar to what Game 1 looked like, where Zest won, but with this type of build and a lot of pressure coming out of the Robo right away.
Hey,
let the pylon finish.
Pretty annoying. All right, so the 3-gate Robo
okay,
on the way.
We have an Oracle coming out here.
Hmm.
Now, when you're doing a pressure build, like what Patience, oh, this is so cute.
didn't even see those adepts there.
Yeah. He's not messing around against that.
Yeah, nicely done. Very preempted there. Oh, wait, what?
Yeah, man. Patience gets in seven probes dead, and he sees that it's an Oracle.
Patience too fast for Shine to catch that right when it came in. Yeah. This is actually so many kills.
It is so many kills.
This is going to set up so nicely. Yeah, you're right, Artos. He has a Protoss. It's Protoss.
Yeah.
That was really nicely done. And one adept even gets out.
So Zest right now is in a world of trouble with this, making that immortal. He'll have that Prism coming out next. And it seems to me that there is almost no way in the entire universe for Zest to win this game.
Well, it was already going to be hard for him to win, but the fact that he lost nine probes back there was just huge.
Yeah.
And now he's going to come forward here, and Zest knows he's in trouble. There's an Oracle that was headed towards the main, but there's a shield battery there. You really need two Oracles if you're going to one-shot workers.
And do you see what Patience is doing, where he's only showing two Stalkers? He's literally hiding all the rest of everything.
Yeah, this is just so smart.
My gosh.
Okay, I don't even know. Zest taps. Yeah. He doesn't even activate the Oracle. He's just like, okay, I'm dead. Okay.
Well, Patience takes that series right down with two strategic victories.
Yeah. You know, that's the thing about Patience. He can kind of sort of beat anybody.
Oh,
and this is going to be scary for Zest now. This is already a pretty damn hard group. Everybody's so good. This is the last group for the round of 32 in GSL. These are our four players left. And, you know, Zest has won GSLs before, guys. For him to go out in the round of 32 is going to be huge. He's not out yet.
Well, if he goes out and we had stats go out, that's not right, Tasis. It's just not right.
It's wrong.
Yeah.
It's amoral. It's a crime against nature.
I'm not even going to watch any more GSL if that happens.
We're going to go to a break. We come back. Alive versus Rogue. Don't go away.